Hi viewers, welcome to our 8th lecture on microbial genetic resources. This is a part of our series of lectures on genetic resources and conservation, the series that we have started and we have reached up till the 8th lecture. In this lecture, we will be talking about the microorganisms, their genetic resources and their uses. The microorganism genetic resources, the term microorganisms include all the organisms that we can see like fungi or microalgae, protozoa, bacteria, viruses. These all are the microorganisms. As they all are living and they all contain a genetic resource and genetic material, so they all make up a genetic resource. And it makes up another category that we already have talked about, the plant genetic resources, and now these are the microbial genetic resources. Microbes, they are playing a very, very important role in our ecosystems, in our soil ecosystem, in our aquatic ecosystem, and everywhere microorganisms are present. And some microorganisms, they are playing a very, very beneficial roles, and while some microorganisms, they are not beneficial, while they are deleterious and they can cause different type of diseases. So first of all, we will be talking about the uses of microorganisms and what role they are playing. The microorganisms, they are playing a beneficial roles as a symbionts. Like if we talk about our microbiota, that the microorganisms that stay in our intestine, it help us in digestion, and in return they get the nutrients from the human body or from the animal's body. So as a symbionts, as the symbionts are the microorganisms that get benefit, and it's like a two-way benefit. When the microorganisms, they are in symbiotic relationship with the host, it means that the microorganisms will get a benefit and the host will get the benefit in return as well. Other than this, the microorganisms, they are playing very important role in nitrogen fixation in the soil. They complete the nitrogen cycle and they help in the biodegradation of the waste material, and of course they break down the organic compounds or the complex molecules into the simpler ones, and these are again went back to the soil and they make the soil enrich with the nutrients. Other than this, the microorganisms, they can be used as in a biocontrol, natural biocontrol, in which the microorganisms, they are used to kill the other pest or to reduce the growth of the herbs or the weeds and the other pest or moths and flies. And the World Federation of Culture Collection, this is a world federation that collect or maintain the culture collections of microorganisms. So culture collections are the collections of microorganisms. So this organization is established in 1970, and this organization promotes the collaboration between the individuals and organizations which are responsible for maintaining and developing culture collections. There are different types of culture collections, and here I have listed only four of them. And the first one is the service collection. The main purpose of a service collection is to supply the authenticated cultures to the ones who request those. These are the authenticated, well-characterized culture collections, and they are generally enlisted in the catalogs, and they have the catalogs available publicly. Everyone can see the culture collections, and then if they need any specific bacteria or microorganism, then they can order those culture collections, and then these culture collections are supplied to them. Other than this, there are in-house collections. The in-house collections, they are usually maintained by the institutes or the organizations or departments for their own use. They do not supply these or sell these at a commercial level, but they use or they maintain these culture collections for themselves. Generally, no catalogs are available for them. And usually they are the special cultural collections because sometimes they have manipulated these microorganisms for their own beneficial use or for their own experiments, and they maintain these culture collections. The third type of culture collection is laboratory suppliers. Laboratory suppliers, they maintain a limited number of culture collections. They maintain only one strain from one category, and then they supply these at commercial level to the teaching or research institutes. And these are commonly used for the research and teaching purposes. And then the laboratory suppliers, they supply these culture collections to these to the targeted sites. And then are the research collections. The research collections, they are being established by one individual, one scientist. These are not like if there are four scientists who are working in one department. So the as a whole, the culture collections that will be available to all the four scientists, they all will be known as collectively, they will be known as in-house collections, but if we talk about a single scientist who has his or her own culture collection, that is known as research collection, because they belongs to one individual or one scientist or one team that is working on those specific microorganisms. So this is a research collection, and usually these research collections, they are lost or they are no more of use when the scientists, they retire or when they shift from one place to another place or they change their area of research. So then these culture collections are usually lost because they belong to one individual. They are not maintained by the institute or the department as a whole. So the microorganism genetic resources, the microbial genetic resources, up till now, it is according to the rough estimates, it is stated that approximately 11 lakh and 20,000 bacteria, they have been conserved, microorganisms, they have been conserved by this World Federation, but there are lots of other strains or other types of the microorganisms that are being discovered every year, that are being characterized every year, but all these bacteria or all these microorganisms, they are not conserved yet. So it is estimated that only 2% of the species that have been known or that have been discovered, they are preserved in the form of culture collections, but all the other 98%, they are not preserved in the form of culture collections. Although they are known, they are being worked on, but they are not preserved or the conserved as a culture collections. Next, we will see the use of microorganisms in the agriculture, that what roles the microorganisms they are playing in the agriculture. The microorganisms, they are presenting a wealth of opportunities for the improvement of food and agriculture, because according to the previous thoughts, it was thought that microorganisms, they all are not beneficial, they all cause diseases, but this is not the case. There are many microorganisms, there are several microorganisms who are beneficial for the plants, for the animals, and they help in the good plant growth and good animal growth. So their first role is a plant growth promotion through the soil microorganisms, because the soil microorganisms, sometimes they are like bacteria or the fungi, they develop a good relationship, they develop a good symbiotic relationship with the plant, and especially the roots, and then they help the plant to get the nutrients like nitrogen and the phosphorus. And sometimes the bacteria or the fungi, they also make the plants drought tolerant or the heat resistant as well. So these help the plant to grow better. And other than this, the microbial pathogens, they can be used in the biocontrol, like your Bacillus thuringiensis, that is also known as BT. Many years ago, when the BT cottons or the BT corns were not developed in those years, these Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a bacteria, these were used to kill the moths or the flies that were attacking the plants and that were reducing the growth of plants. So these bacteria, as they release a toxin, so this toxin, when is ingested by the moths or the flies, they just block or make the holes in the gut of those pests and then they die. So these bacteria were used for the biocontrol, for the control of those pests instead of chemical pesticides. And other than this, there are several fungi types or other bacteria as well that are being used to control the growth of other pests or the weeds. Then is the role of microorganisms, symbiotic relationship of these microorganisms in the ruminant livestock. Ruminant livestock are the ruminant animals, are those animals who have different chambers of their stomach, and they the first part they only fertilize the plant material, and after that they do the rumination, and then this plant part is again ingested and digested well. So they have four chambers of their stomach. So these bacteria, they are also present in their stomach chambers, and they help in the fermentation process or in the digestion process. Other than this, these microorganisms, they can also be used in the agriculture industry to develop different chemicals or to help in developing various beneficial pesticides or beneficial chemicals that can be used for increasing the growth of plant, for increasing the production of the plants. So these were all about the microorganisms, their benefits and their uses. And these all microorganisms, they comprise the microbial genetic resources. And it is very important to study these microbial genetic resources, because they are, these microorganisms, they are benefiting the humans in the agriculture as well as in various other fields of life. So it is very important to study these microorganisms and conserve these microbial genetic resources. Okay, viewers, thank you so much for watching my video. For my other videos, please subscribe to my channel, that is MH Biology, and keep watching my videos. And there are several videos that are on the topic, that is genetic resources and conservation. Up till then, goodbye.